We know there are many choices in internet radio, and the staff and host of LA Talk Live would like to thank you for choosing the internet's hottest destination for the most eclectic sound and invigorating talk. This is LA Talk Live. We are more than just talk.
The dialogue. The community voice of Southern California's Young Professional Network. Relevant discussions about the thoughts, concerns, opportunities, and challenges faced by today's generational leaders.
Real talk, real people.
This is The Dialogue.
The Dialogue.
With Starlett Quarles
on LA Talk Live
and streaming live
at www.latalklive.com.
Welcome once again to The Dialogue, Real Talk, Real People. I'm your host, Starlett Quarles, and we're on live at latalklive.com and streaming live at 1690 AM, the one, the voice of the voiceless in Omaha, Nebraska. As always, The Dialogue is the voice of our generation, so thank you so much for joining us here every Wednesday from 5 to 6:30, where we like to discuss the topics that are relevant to today's generational leaders. It is November, so we are starting and launching a new series tonight. This month, we're going to be talking about health disparities in the Black community. We want to focus on health issues that are drastically impacting the quality of life of the Black community. Many of us know that the Black community is disproportionately at the top of the list of almost every chronic and deathly disease. Now, for the sake of our discussion, what I'd like to do is define the term health disparities so that we're all on the same page. Now, it's also called healthcare inequality in some countries and refers to the gap in quality of health and healthcare across racial, ethnic, sexual orientation, and socioeconomic groups. Now, I'm going to read, you have a definition on your screen. In fact, the Health and Resources and Service Administration defines health disparities as population-specific differences in the presence of disease, health outcomes, or access to healthcare. In the United States, health disparities are well documented in minority populations such as African Americans, Native Americans, Asian Americans, and Latinos. Among the disease-specific examples of racial and ethnic disparities in the United States is the cancer incidence rate among African Americans, which is 10% higher than among whites. In addition, adult African Americans and Latinos have approximately twice the risk as whites of developing diabetes. Minorities also have higher rates of cardiovascular disease, HIV and AIDS, and infant mortality, more so than whites. And this is found on the news-medical.net website. So this month, we're going to talk about some of these health inequalities, including prostate cancer, mental illness, and we're going to have part two of our discussion on HIV and AIDS all month long here on The Dialogue. So make sure you tune in every Wednesday from 5 to 6:30 p.m. right here on latalklive.com. Now, for tonight's conversation, we're going to talk about the Affordable Care Act, or Obamacare, as many of us know it. And we all know that there have been a plethora of issues on the rollout for Obamacare, including the jacked up website, the attack of the Republicans to try to repeal the ACA, to the misinformation given to the Black community about Obamacare and all the scams that are out there. So we want to educate you and inform you on what is Obamacare and how can you enroll and how it's actually benefiting the Black community. So we want to hear from you today. This is a community conversation. Give us a call, 323-473-3100, 323-473-3100. Our conversation tonight is Obamacare 101, as well as health disparities in the Black community. And we have an extraordinary panel of guests, which include Dr. Chris Hickey, Senior, who is the Executive Director of Each One, Teach One, Connie Kizzy Gillette, founder of Lily's Care Circle, Norma Intumi, co-founder of Shields for Family, Dr. Richard Allen Williams, who is a clinical professor of medicine at the UCLA School of Medicine, and my good friend Tori Bailey, who is a certified healthcare educator with Covered for California. So they're all here to educate you on the health disparities in the Black community, specifically on Obamacare. So it's Obamacare 101, y'all. We're teaching you guys about the Affordable Care Act. So, but before we go to a commercial break, I have a couple of community announcements that I'd like to make. The first one is a town hall meeting that's being hosted by Congresswoman Karen Bass, who, you know, is a good friend to the Dialogue. She launched my show as my first guest. But this Sunday, November 10th, from 1 to 5 p.m. at West LA College, she's actually doing a town hall on the Affordable Care Act. There will be an enrollment counselors on hand for you to sign up right away for health care coverage. And if you already have health insurance, just come to the town hall to learn more how Obamacare affects you. There will be some community clinics, which will also be on hand to provide free medical checkups, blood pressure and diabetes screenings, as well as flu shots. Again, this is the Obamacare Town Hall sponsored by Congresswoman Karen Bass this Sunday, November 10th from 1 to 5 p.m. at West LA College. To RSVP, please visit aca37.eventbrite.com or call 323-965-1422. The second community announcement that I'd like to announce, next week we're going to be talking about prostate cancer and Black men. So I wanted to share an event that's happening this Saturday, November 9th from 1 to 3 p.m. It is a prostate cancer screening and education event sponsored by Trinity CDC, Trinity Baptist Church, and a host of community partners. It's free and confidential. So, gentlemen, I beg you, if you have not gotten your prostate check, please go get your prostate check. If you're 35 and older, we need our Black men. So please go and get your prostate checked this Saturday for free. And did I say it was confidential? This Saturday, 323-735-0044 is the number that you need to call. 323-735-0044. Again, this is a free prostate cancer screening and education for all my brothers out there. So please, we adore you. So please go and get your prostate checked this Saturday for free. That is it for our community announcements. Again, we're going to be talking about health disparities in the Black community all month long. Tonight, starting with our conversation on Obamacare 101. Again, give us a call here, 323-473-3100. I know you got some questions on Obamacare, so the phone lines will be open for you, 323-473-3100. You can always send your questions, post them on our Facebook page, facebook.com/thedialoguela. You can tweet me at StarQuar or text me if you have my cell number. And if you're not watching us on the computer, you can always download an app on your phone through Ustream or TuneIn Radio to take us on the road with you. And please join our mailing list at thedialoguela.com. That is thedialoguela.com. We're going to take a quick commercial break. And when we come back, we're going to jump right into our conversation on health disparities in the Black community, specifically tonight, Obamacare 101. Right here with me, Starlett Quarles on The Dialogue, Real Talk, Real People. We'll be right back.
We know there are many choices in internet radio, and the staff and host of LA Talk Live would like to thank you for choosing the internet's hottest destination for the most eclectic sound and invigorating talk. This is LA Talk Live. We are more than just talk.
I remember the early days of my business when I started with a personal computer, new business cards, and my line of credit was on plastic.
Now things have changed and you have a real job creating business.
Recently, I turned to my bank for a new loan and found out they couldn't meet my needs. I now realize that after the credit crisis, many financial institutions no longer have bankers with the necessary expertise to understand my business or have the ability to provide flexible credit solutions.
You searched for a better solution from someone with financial knowledge of a big bank and common sense understanding of a small business.
I found Michael Banner and the Los Angeles LDC, who solved my problem and exceeded my expectations. Now, when I have a credit or other financial need, my first call is to the Los Angeles LDC. They've earned my trust by providing the best credit solutions and advice at affordable rates and terms. Where do you go when the banks say no?
Los Angeles LDC, a community development financial institution, on the web at losangelesldc.com or by phone 800-366-1178.
Loans made under a commercial finance lender's license from the California Department of Corporations. Do you have or know of someone with a child or adult family member with developmental disabilities that would benefit from a social recreation program in the South Los Angeles area? At Ability First's Harry A. Meyer Center at 8090 Crenshaw Boulevard in Inglewood, we offer afternoon and after-school care programs for children and adults with disabilities, which includes socialization, recreation, community outings, independent living skill training, as well as physical fitness activities. You can reach us at 323-753-3101 and visit us at www.abilityfirst.org.
Welcome back. Welcome back to The Dialogue. Real talk, real people. I'm your host, Starlett Quarles, and we're on live at latalklive.com. And we're taking your calls today, 323-473-3100. 323-473-3100. We're talking about Obamacare 101. We're bringing you up to speed on what's happening with the Affordable Care Act, how you can get enrolled, and to talk about some of those myths that are being put out there about the Obamacare. So we want to be able to educate our community on what is actually beneficial for them. So let's jump right into our conversation. I'm going to introduce my esteemed panel of guests today and experts, starting with Dr. Chris L. Hickey, Sr. He is the Executive Director of Each One, Teach One Alliance for Academic Access, Achievement, and Success, which is an organization that focuses on the efforts to heighten community awareness of the overwhelming importance of reforming educational practices targeting at-risk youth, as well as community awareness of the Affordable Care Act, or Obamacare. He has been recruited to provide workshops and training on healthcare options under Covered California. Please, ladies and gentlemen, welcome Dr. Hickey to The Dialogue. Welcome, sir.
Thank you very much, Scott.
Thank you for joining us today.
It's my pleasure to be
here. I'm excited to have you.
Thank you.
Sitting next to Dr. Hickey, we have Connie Kizzy Gillette, who is the executive director and founder of Lily's Care Circle. Lily's Care Circle is dedicated to combating and nurturing those with chronic diseases such as dementia, high blood pressure, and elevated cholesterol. Ooh, that sounds like me. Their unique improvement methods utilize education, nutrition, and communication to reduce stress and lessen the amount of time our patients spend at their doctor's office and in or the hospital. She started Lily's Care Circle when she experienced the effects of Crohn's disease firsthand when her loving mother, Lily, began to suffer from dementia. She is also a Covered California Certified Educator. Please welcome Miss Connie Kizzy Gillette to The Dialogue. Welcome,
Thank you.
Ma'am.
Thank you.
We also have Miss Norma Ntumeng, who is the co-founder, Chief Financial and Operations Officer for Shields for Family. She is also the co-founder of UMA Community Clinic, which is a federally qualified health clinic in South Los Angeles. She is an instructor at the Charles Drew University of Medicine and Science College of Medicine Research Department and Community Engagement Division. For over 40 years, she has shared her expertise in substance abuse and mental health treatment services, as well as in the administration, including operations, financial management, human resources, and administrative services. And she went to school with my aunt, Lisi. We call her Lisi, but please welcome Norma Ntumeng to The Dialogue. Welcome.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for joining us. And sitting next to Norma is Dr. Richard Allen Williams, who is a clinical professor of medicine at the UCLA School of Medicine. He is also the president and CEO of the Minority Health Institute Incorporated and founder of the Association of Black Cardiologists Incorporated. Dr. Williams promoted a new concept called humane medicine for years, which was designed to restructure the way in which medicine is taught and practiced in the United States. This concept eventually took on a new name called cultural competency, and has formed the basis of the concept of healthcare disparities. His aim is to revise medical school curriculum to include subjects dealing with infrequently taught topics such as women's health issues, issues pertaining to race, ethnicity, culture, and religion, biomedical ethics, stress and violence in society, nutrition, microbiology, and genetics, Nutrition and the Management of Death and Dying. And trust me, this is just a brief introduction. Dr. Williams had 4 pages of a bio that I, but he is absolutely an expert. I'm so honored to have Dr. Richard Allen Williams here on The Dialogue. Thank you. And last but certainly not least is my BCCLA sister, yes. Tori Bailey, who is also a certified healthcare educator with Covered California. Tori has been in the managerial and director positions for the past 15 to 20 years in the health information and in the field of health information administration. She taught as an educator at Charles Drew University and others on the medical issues regarding patient privacy and confidentiality, also known as the HIPAA law. She is a conduit to the community as a at large, from homeless to political statesman who served under her great uncle, a longtime House of Representatives, as a page in the elementary school. Therefore, she is no stranger to politics, and she is also a certified healthcare educator. And I think I mentioned that. So please. Oh, and also she wanted to read that she's a master. She has a master's in leadership and management. What do you want to say?
The mission.
Oh, what's the mission? Embarking on a unified collaboration amongst individuals to be the key to connecting the dots and closing the gaps for a successful outcome of excellence within organizations. That's so please right. welcome Ms. Tori right. Bailey to The Dialogue.
Thank you, Starlett.
I had to get it all in, girl. I had to get it all in. All right, so we are about to have a very informative conversation on Obamacare. So we definitely want you to give us a call here, 323-473-3100. So I'm just going to start off by asking the panel, and any of you can answer. So just give us a reminder, what exactly is the Affordable Care Act or Obamacare, and explain its fruition.
Well, I guess I'll start.
Okay, Tori.
Primarily, I want to start with saying that the premise of the Health Care Act is that it is patient protection.
Okay.
Affordable Health Care Act. And people have a tendency
to... So elaborate on that. What do you mean by patient protection?
Patient protection is that we're here to protect the entirety of the health care of an individual.
Okay, very good.
That makes up a family.
Okay.
And so we want to make sure that patient protection is included. And what I mean by that, there is a HEDIS, mm-hmm. is a part of the Affordable Health Care Act. And that's where it balances out the playing field.
Okay.
HEDIS is the health effectiveness,
okay.
with the data and the information set that is inclusive in all of this. And so when they collect the data on anyone who is enrolling in Obamacare, which is meant to be similar to universal care, mm-hmm. which is health care, we'll be able to have the research data extrapolated from all of this.
Okay.
If someone wishes to do further research, as Dr. Williams here, and all of us from a local level to get better treatment.
Okay. Okay. So explain, anyone can explain. So why was this, you know, Universal Health Care Act? Why did Obama, you know, even strive to put this bill into law? Talk about the need for the Affordable Care Act.
Well, one of the things I want to talk about first is with respect to the names.
Okay.
I really want to make it clear to our community. We hear a number of names like Obamacare and the Affordable Care Act. So one of the things I always like to start off with in California is called Covered California.
Okay, thank you.
And it's important that our community understand that because the outreach through the radio and television is going to say Covered California.
Okay, very
good.
And we
don't want that to go over the heads of our community looking for Obamacare.
They're okay. not going
to, only for the most part, we hear Obamacare in the news when it's something negative, when
okay.
they have something to save us. So we want our Californians to be aware that it's Covered California.
Covered California. And I believe we have a graphic that has the information mm-hmm. on how to get access to Covered California. But you wanted to say, in terms of just the need of Obama to even create this law and to put it into, to create this bill and to put it into law.
Well, one of the things that's important to understand that throughout the world, particularly the free world, we're the one of the last ones to have this kind of care
okay.
for our people, where it's universal health care. And so it's not something that's new. It's not something that he created. In fact, we know that in Massachusetts, they already had a program like that. In Canada, uh-huh. they have a program like
okay.
that. So I think what President Obama was wanting to do was even the playing field with respect to Americans having access to affordable, quality care. And all Americans having access to it in our country, and we'll talk about it later, but we have disparities.
Absolutely.
And a lot of that disparity, those disparities come from individuals in our community particularly not being able to afford care.
Okay.
And so as all of us know, you know, if you go to an emergency room or if you have something happen to you that's unexpected, and an unexpected illness, so to speak, if you don't have the money, it becomes devastating.
Absolutely.
And so I think that that's the primary premise for him creating
this. Okay, excellent. So Connie, there has been this talk recently in the news, specifically this week. I mean, every day there's something going on where they're attacking Obama and Obamacare or the Affordable Care Act. So now the issue is that if your doctor is not covered, you know, he said if you already have insurance, that your doctor will still remain. So now he's kind of saying, oh, well, maybe if they don't sign up. So elaborate or explain what's happening if your doctor is not, if you already have insurance, but then your doctor opts out of the program or your provider.
But I'd first like to start with what Covered California is here.
Okay.
And Covered California is our state new health insurance law. It's the marketplace where we can go and buy insurance.
Okay.
And there are four organizations, Blue Shield, Kaiser, Molina, and LA Healthcare. And if you already have insurance, you can stay with that insurance company. But a lot of, I think the reasons that the people are opting out is because some of the insurance companies are not offering the 10 essentials.
Okay, and we're going to get to that. So you named four specific insurance carriers. Now, those are the only ones in California?
The only ones in California.
Okay, so if you can repeat that again.
Kaiser, Molina, LA Healthcare, and
Southern California.
Okay. And Kaiser, Molina, LA Healthcare, and Blue Shield Blue Cross.
And then what else?
Well, don't count out the Medi-Cal. Okay. That has to be a part of the entire picture.
Okay. 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 All right. Very good. Okay. And so you had alluded to these 10 essentials. Now you're saying some of the providers are opting out if they don't have these 10 essential health benefits that the government mandates, right?
Right.
So let's talk about these 10 essentials. So you have the ambulatory patient services, prescription drugs, emergency care, mental health services, hospitalization, rehabilitative and habilitative services, preventive and wellness services, laboratory services, pediatric care, including vision and dental, and maternity and newborn care at no extra cost. So, Dr. Williams, why these 10 essential health benefits? Why were these mandated?
Well, first of all, let me mention some preliminary things in regards to all of the questions that you've covered so far.
Very good.
First thing that I want to say is that this is a wonderful opportunity for people to understand what Obamacare is all about, and I'm happy to contribute to that. We need to recognize a little bit of history here, the fact that this is not just an act, it is now the law of the land.
Very good.
And it's important for people to know that.
Yes.
Another thing is to recognize when it began. It was signed. The act was signed into law on March 23rd, 2010.
Mm-hmm.
So it's already been in effect over three years. And now it's going on towards full implementation.
Okay.
As far as the essential health benefits are concerned, let me tie that in to that list that you gave into something that's very important, and that's the question about whether people can keep their health insurance that they already have, or whether they are going to have that canceled for whatever reason. Be very specific about this. 95% of the people who have insurance are okay and can keep their health insurance.
Okay.
There are 5% of the people who either don't have coverage or whose insurance policies don't include these 10 essential benefits, which are mandated under the ACA law.
Okay.
And if a health insurance policy does not have these essential benefits, the individual who either is covered or wants to get such a policy cannot do so. The coverage, they need to get another policy, which does include it. Now, I hope that clears up a lot of the confusion in regards to what's been put out there about what President Obama promised and said about you can keep your policy if you already got it and that sort of thing.
And so you're saying, go ahead.
This goes back to what Tory mentioned about the fact that this is a law which protects the people.
Mm-hmm.
And these essential health benefits are protections.
Absolutely.
And if they're not in a policy, you don't get that protection.
And I would think that you would want to have these 10 essential items.
Absolutely.
So if your provider doesn't provide it, I think it would just benefit you to find one that does. Now, there might be, and I'm not sure, if your provider doesn't have these 10 essentials and you have to switch, is there a possibility that your premiums could go up?
There is a possibility, but remember, there is also a mandate that there would be a cap on the amount of premiums that an individual can pay.
Okay.
The cap, I believe, is in the neighborhood of about $6,350 a year.
Okay.
And about $12,700 for a family of four.
Okay.
And so, essentially, if it's necessary to switch, even though there may be a small rise in the premium that one pays now, it can't exceed that cap by law.
Okay,
and
excellent.
People need to understand that.
Very good. So I'm going to play.
And in addition to that, also, and that was eloquent. I'm glad you brought that out. In addition, if the new insurance that people are required to get is unaffordable,
mm-hmm.
they can also get financial assistance from
right.
the government.
That's
so
right.
Initially, the report is that people's premiums are going up, but they can get financial assistance for not only the premium, but even the out-of-pocket.
Okay.
So it could ultimately end up for some people being less than what they had with the 10 essential benefits.
That's
okay.
exactly
Very
right.
Good.
And for those, the layman term, that's what Dr. Chris just alluded to, but that is what they call the subsidy.
Okay.
That's right.
So people, when they hear subsidy, that's exactly what it is in layman's terms, what Dr. Hickey just alluded to.
Okay.
And I want to mention one last thing in regards to these benefits. If you don't believe us, these folks sitting around the table who are all experts in regards to Obamacare, you might believe an article which appeared in the LA Times, an editorial on this past November 1st, just a few days ago. And it's called Cancellation Blues.
Mm-hmm.
It's an editorial, and it's specifically about the 10 essential benefits and the loss of one's health insurance and higher premiums and all that sort of thing.
And the medication.
Right, and the medications. And it's important to understand that the propaganda that has been promulgated in regards to Obamacare is simply not true. You mentioned at the beginning, Starlett, that there are certain myths which mm-hmm. are out there. That's one of the myths.
Okay,
and we have to make sure that we focus on the essential truths.
Yes.
Okay,
yes.
And I'm going to talk about five more myths. I happen to see this television program called the Obama Survival Guide. There's this book that is out that is trying to educate the community on the Obama Survival. It's called the Obamacare Survival Guide, and they talk about five essential changes that's going to happen as a result. So we're going to play a little bit audio from this, and then we're going to talk about these five changes that they mentioned in this commercial.
There are five major changes coming with Obamacare, and you need to be ready. First, there are a lot of reports predicting widespread doctor shortages. There's also been a lot in the media about the formation of independent advisory boards. What are they, and how will they change your health care? Medicare benefits are changing. In fact, if you're retired or nearing retirement, you need to understand the impact. And then there are the cost issues. Obamacare allows insurance companies to pass increased costs on to you in the form of higher premiums, copays, and deductibles. Plus, there are a myriad of new taxes and fees, including a home sales tax, a new excise tax on so-called Cadillac health plans, and more taxes on high-income earners.
Dr. Williams, let's start with the first one. Doctor shortages. Are there going to be some doctor shortages? What are they referring to?
There definitely will be doctor shortages.
Okay, well, why?
It's because of the fact that we've always had doctor shortages, mm-hmm. and we don't have enough medical students in school. Enough doctors, especially black doctors, being turned out. Obamacare does provide for the development of more doctors, especially in areas of great need. So we do have doctor shortages. Obamacare, at least in part, will attempt to address that problem. And we will find that at least by 2020, a lot of this deficit that we have in the doctor shortage will be ameliorated.
So the doctor shortage is not a result of Obamacare. It's just something
that
has been
not.
Going on for whatever. And do you have any comments, Norma?
No. We know if you think now how long it takes you to get an appointment at the doctor. Mm. And like Dr. Williams was saying, it exists already.
Okay.
And with more folks coming into the system, there is that potential. But knowing that in advance, there should have been some things that we put into place to make sure that that's mitigated as much as possible.
Okay.
And another aspect to the doctor shortage is the fact that a lot of the doctors are opting out of the program.
Okay. And why are they opting out? Are they losing money? Are they not being doctors anymore? What are they doing?
Again, it puts a highlight.
Yeah, one of the things about the law, one of the purposes is to help to reduce healthcare costs.
Okay.
And to increase the good outcomes that our people have when they go to the doctor.
Okay, very good.
And one of the things, the next thing is the advisory boards. There'll be boards that will be monitoring what's going on in terms of outpatients, in terms of outcomes for patients.
Okay.
Right now, if you go to the doctor, your blood pressure's high, he gives you a prescription, you go home, you come back, blood pressure's still high, he gives you a prescription, you go home. And this goes on and on and on. But under the law, under this new law, outcomes need to get better.
Okay.
Or else your payment may become
less. There's a sense of accountability.
There is.
Independent advisor or accountability.
Yes.
Okay. I want to say something else about doctors opting out. You know, there are a lot of scare tactics which are being used to make people feel afraid of Obamacare, thinking that it's just the worst thing, as Dr. Ben Carson said, the worst thing since slavery.
I can't believe he said that.
We'll talk more about that later on.
Yeah, I mean, he was very disappointing, but go ahead,
very disappointing. Used to be a great hero.
I know, right? but I'm sorry, go ahead.
Idiot now. But in any event, I want to make sure that everybody recognizes that this book that you talked about, The Survival Guide, has been on the
bestsellers list.
On the bestsellers.
Yes, it has.
The New York Times and other bestsellers lists throughout the country, the world. And it's really unfortunate. I wrote a book which is called Healthcare Disparities at the Intersection with Healthcare Reform. And it is at the crossroads with healthcare reform.
Can you pass me Dr. Williams with?
Oh, sure.
Okay.
And I'd like to be a little commercial here.
That's okay. You can give us a plug for Healthcare Disparities at the Crossroads with Healthcare Reform by Dr. Williams.
You'll be picked up at Springer.com or at Amazon.com, and several members of our panel have that book
Excellent. So this, instead of Obama, a survival guide, this is what you get, Black folks.
Right. This tells the truth.
Okay.
All right. And we want to make sure that people do have the truth.
Okay. Excellent.
See that.
You want to say something?
Yes, Charlie. Before we get away from the point about doctor shortages, I also see this as an opportunity. And we'll get a chance to talk about it later. But there's a great connection between how kids feel academically and how they achieve academically. So what I'm looking at with respect to doctor shortages is if our kids are feeling better and they're achieving better in school, these are opportunities for them to go into the medical profession. So I see in our community, we should encourage our young people to go into the medical profession. There'll be plenty of opportunity for them to not only become doctors and other medical practitioners, but they can come back into our community and bring some of their services back, raising the health outcomes in our community.
Excellent. We are attacking the myths of the Obamacare. We've already talked about the doctor shortages and the independent advisory boards. When we come back, we're going to talk about the last three, Medicare benefit changes, increased costs, and new taxes and fees, right here on The Dialogue. We want to hear from you. 323-473-3100. 323-473-3100. I know you have a bunch of questions about Obamacare and some of the health disparities in the Black community. So we want to hear from you. We're going to take a quick commercial break, and then we'll be right back. Ouch! We'll be right back.
We know there are many choices in internet radio, and the staff and host of LA Talk Live would like to thank you for choosing the internet's hottest destination for the most eclectic sound and invigorating talk. This is LA Talk Live. We are more than just talk.
Young Connection, your one-stop connection for all your graphic design and commercial printing needs. Young Connection is a full-service printing and media design company dedicated to providing the highest level of customer service and satisfaction. Young Connection provides swift response and rapid turnaround services for banners, brochures, business cards, letterheads, church bulletins, funeral programs, flyers, logo design, posters, and much, much more, all at an affordable price. Young Connection, the official printing company of LA Talk Live. Give them a call at 310-491-3336. That's 310-491-3336. Or visit their website at www.youngconnection.com. That's www.youngconnection.com. Young Connection Printing and Media Services, proud sponsors of LA Talk Live, where it's more than just talk.
Interested in advertising your business, product, or service here on The Dialogue? Call 323-547-7748. The Dialogue will help you promote your business, increase your traffic, and bring in new clients through innovative and creative marketing packages, including affordable radio ad campaigns for small businesses. Find out more. Call 323-547-7748. That's 323-547-7748. Or go to www.thedialoguela.com. And now, back to The Dialogue.
The Dialogue.
With Starlett Quarles.
Real talk. Real people.
Welcome back. Welcome back to The Dialogue. Real talk, real people. I'm your host, Starlett Quarles, and we're on live at LATalkLive.com, tackling health disparities in the Black community all month long here on our show. And tonight we are talking about Obamacare 101. And before we left to commercial break, we were talking about the Obamacare Survival Guide, which we don't want you to purchase. What we actually want you to purchase to increase your IQ on Obamacare is Dr. Richard Allen Williams' book, Healthcare Disparities at the Crossroads with Healthcare Reform. So make sure you get Dr. Williams' book. We don't want to get the Obamacare Survival Guide, but for Black folks, this is our survival guide. So before we went to the commercial break, we were talking about these five changes that the Obamacare Survival Guide book mentioned. And we talked about the Medicare benefit changes. Will there be changes in Medicare? And what would that look like? Anybody?
Not really.
Okay.
And let me say one other thing about Medicare. People have been given the impression that doctors are not going to accept patients who are covered by Medicare and Medi-Cal or Medicaid.
Right.
The truth of it is that there may be a decreased premium, so to speak, that will be paid for patients on Medi-Cal or Medicaid, but and that might dissuade some doctors from seeing those patients. But in actual fact, Obamacare has got that covered because for at least the first 3 years of Medicaid expansion, the federal government will cover 100% of the costs for Medi-Cal, for Medi-Cal coverage.
Excellent.
And people need to know that. That means essentially that the program is paid for. Nobody needs to worry about that. The state government doesn't have to worry about it. And as far as doctors are concerned, the payment to doctors will be equal, brought up to be equal to that for Medicare.
Okay.
And so that's an incentive to doctors to see those patients.
All right. And Connie, what about these increased costs and new taxes and fees?
Okay. The penalty for not having health insurance for the first year, which is 2014, will be 1% or $95 per adult and $47.50 per child, up to $285 for a family.
So that's a one-time fee?
That's a one-time fee.
So if you don't get health insurance for the whole year of 2014, you just pay $95 penalty fee?
Yes.
Okay.
The second year, 2015, will increase to 2%.
Okay.
And that'll be $325 per adult and $162.50 per child, up to $975 per family.
Okay.
2016 and beyond, it'll go to 2.5%, $695 per adult, and $347.50 per child, up to $2,085 for a family.
Now, I know Obamacare helps those who are unemployed, who don't have, you know, income. So how do they manage these fees? How are they able to take care of these fees if they don't have the income?
Now, I'll take that to Dr. Williams.
Oh. Well, first of all, everybody is eligible to be covered. And if people can't pay the premiums, they can get subsidies.
Okay.
And the subsidies are provided by Obamacare.
Very good.
Now, of course, that increases the cost of Obamacare. But that's already been factored in. Obamacare was signed into law at a cost of $940 billion. Mm. All of that money has already been appropriated. Mm-hmm. The bill, the law is paid for. So nobody should have
any. So there is no excuse.
Exactly.
If you don't have a job, if you don't unemployed, there is no excuse for you not to get any type of health insurance starting in 2014.
Right. That's exactly right.
All right.
The Medi-Cal. Oh, sorry.
I'm sorry. Go ahead, Norma.
And my understanding is that if you can substantiate that you just really can't afford this, mm-hmm. you have the documentation to show that, then you will not be penalized. You may be able to have that waived because, I mean, we know living in the community, there are some people that are really, really living.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, they make too much to get on Medi-Cal maybe, but they just $5 short of being able to pay that premium.
Right.
And there's a way, you know, that, but we don't want people to think that, especially the younger folks who are, I'm healthy, I don't really need mm-hmm. this insurance, I'll just pay the $95. Mm. Want them to keep in mind that that's one of the primary ways that folks go bankrupt in this country is by getting a chronic right. disorder or an illness,
mm-hmm. right.
and it costs so much money that it just sets you back for years. You think those student loans are high?
Okay. still paying my student loans.
Yeah.
Right.
But, couple that with getting ill and not having an
Absolutely.
Insurance.
Absolutely. So what about, there are three ways in which you can sign up. So what are the ways in which you can sign up for Obamacare?
No, the premium cost. The premium, the cost sharing.
No, to sign up, to enroll in Obamacare.
By phone.
Paper, by internet.
Online. Oh, by phone. Oh, okay.
Okay, I'm sorry. Dr. Williams, you were saying?
Covered CA.
Covered CA. There's three ways. So it's not the healthcare.gov site, right? We go to coveredcalifornia.com.
CoveredCA.com.
Mm-hmm. I believe we have a graphic for that. And so the three ways in which you can enroll is you can call, and what are the other ways, Dr. Williams?
Well, you can go to a site which at which you can sit down and give an individual there who is a certified navigator for Covered California your information, mm-hmm. and you can sign up there. There are a number of sites all around the city, for instance.
And again, we mentioned at the top of the show that Congresswoman Karen Bass is going to be hosting a town hall this Saturday, so you can get up and signed up this Saturday if you like. Yes, Norma?
And the third way is by mail.
By mail. Right. Okay, excellent. But there are some scams. There are some scams out there that are being marketed as a way of having to pay to get into Obamacare, so you do not have to pay. So talk about some of these scams, and how are they finding people? How are people getting scammed by signing up for Obamacare?
Well, one of the things I want to point out right now, and we were making the point that it's Covered CA,
okay.
because there is a site Covered
right.
California.
That's
okay.
right.
And so that's one of I don't want to call it a scam, but it is not the official exchange site.
Okay.
It's important that our individuals know that it is coveredca.com. And as you were saying, you can go through one of the entities, there are churches, mm-hmm. et cetera, and nonprofit organizations, and they can sit down with a certified enrollment counselor mm-hmm. and walk them through it if they're doing it through the website. And then, as they mentioned, you can do it yourself through the website, or you could do it by mail.
And so how are people getting discovered that they're getting scammed? Are they saying, hey, I paid this guy to enroll in Obamacare and I don't have any insurance? I mean, how are they getting discovered?
Well, that's why it's so important that we have outlets like we're doing now,
okay.
the radio show that you're
that's
doing.
Right.
It's really important that all of us that are involved and are understanding that we're out in the community making sure that people know. And one of the first things that we want them to understand is do not pay anybody anything.
Okay.
That's right.
You've done it. As soon as they tell you how much money it's going to cost, that's something that you don't want to be
okay,
involved
Tori.
In.
And then remember, when I said Covered California, it really, CA means California. So mm-hmm. that's one of the main mm-hmm. things. When you say Covered California, you got to make sure we do reiterate every time that is is coveredca.com.
Okay. Now, Connie, you mentioned that there are four different plans. I mean, I know you're not going to go into the details, but what are these different plans and how are they determined?
The bronze, the silver, the gold, and the platinum.
Okay.
And you you pay 1% and a percentage, and then you might be able to get a premium assistant, but I can't go into the details over the phone. You have to talk to over the air, you have to talk to a certified assister or use coveredca.com or call in because we can't give out that information.
Okay.
But I did speak at a church a couple of weeks ago, and a lot of people had been scammed, had, mm-hmm. you know, written checks to insurance companies mm-hmm. and things. So we have to make that plain. Do not exchange any money. Once you sign up, right. you will get a bill from the insurance company mm-hmm. itself.
Now, are these people getting reimbursed, or are these people getting prosecuted? I mean, are they taking advantage of the elderly?
Well, I don't. It wasn't elderly people.
Okay.
It was just some church people that said that they had given up $250, $300.
Wow. Okay.
People had come to their homes.
Mm-hmm.
So you have to have your Covered California certified badge, mm-hmm. call in, or look on the website to make sure that they're from an entity or somebody that Covered California has
Pre-approved,
yeah. yes, and just okay. don't let anybody come in. Or make sure you go to the church or an entity. Look online. It'll list the people that have been, you know, certified to do these things, and make sure you just do not exchange any money. No money.
Now talk about how...
excuse me.
I'm sorry, go ahead.
Before you go on, I want to make a big point.
Okay.
Something that you mentioned or asked about Medicare. It should be pointed out that if an individual is on Medicare, that individual does not need to obtain any additional insurance, doesn't need to have another insurance plan,
okay.
except maybe for supplemental insurance.
Okay.
But in fact, it is illegal for insurance companies to sell full insurance policies to anybody on Medicare.
Okay.
And that is stated very firmly by the federal government.
You cover that in your book?
No.
Okay. So good. So I'm glad you mentioned it. Okay.
So
very good. In terms of preconditions and those that are suffering with preconditions, how does Obamacare or Covered California, how do those assist individuals who have preconditions?
Okay. Pre-existing was covered since March 23rd, 2010.
Okay.
They just make it more global now because of the work that they're putting in, the public relations that they're putting in for Obamacare or the Affordable Health Care Act.
Okay.
Pre-existing diagnosis should not have been denied since implementation of the law.
Okay. All right. So if they do get denied,
they should not get
okay.
denied. But if they do get denied, please bring it to the attention of the people within the hospital. They have caseworkers, they have case management. There's a lot of outlets that you can go to report that.
Now, what about students? I know, is there an effort to get on college campuses and to educate students about signing up? And what are the efforts? Because, you know, in college they think they're healthy, right? Like you said, but it benefits them just as much. So talk about how it benefits students and young adults.
Yes, I was just at a meeting today with a number of community-based organizations
okay.
who are doing enrollment and education to get folks enrolled, and that is a big push. They have a few categories that are really being targeted, and the millennials are one of them,
mm-hmm.
just because of the invincible, you know, mm-hmm. when you're 18 or
right.
19, you don't
right.
ever get anything. But at Shields, we're looking to partner with Charles Drew Medical School, and some of the public health students have volunteered to come over and partner with us so that they can target students in their school, but also in other local colleges around, because they're realizing how important it is. But one thing about the student piece is that you can stay on your parents' insurance until you're 26.
Yes.
Oh.
And, well, not just students, but young people.
There's a whole lot of people still living at home.
Yes.
It is.
We in a recession.
So they say.
Yeah. And it used to be that you needed to be in school and be able to verify that you're in school. But now, up to 26 years of age, it doesn't matter your status. You can be married. You can be living with your folks. You could be living not with your folks. You can be in school or out of school. You're still eligible to be on your parents' plan. So that's a family discussion that
Excellent.
You need to have, whether or not it's more beneficial
mm-hmm.
for you to not be a dependent of your folks
mm-hmm.
and go get your own, or if it's better for the family if you stay on there, so on their plan. So
okay.
that's a consideration.
And how does it help? I mean, we have a lot of entrepreneurs who have businesses. So how does it help small businesses in terms of providing healthcare options to their employees?
How does the the law?
Mm-hmm.
Well, first of all, there are two mandates in the law. One is the individual mandate that everybody has to have insurance coverage, and the employer mandate.
Small business, that is, all
businesses have to provide health care insurance if they have 50 or more employees. What this does is to give an opportunity to businesses to cover their employees in a lawful manner, and it may even save them money. In fact, okay. It probably will. If they do not, they get penalized,
mm-hmm.
just like an individual would be penalized, only they get penalized more. Mm-hmm. One thing that's important to recognize is that the part that deals with businesses won't really go into effect. It's been delayed until 2015.
Okay, very good.
And those are the business with 50 or more employees.
That's
there
correct.
Is an option
right.
for those with 50 or below.
Okay,
49.
Voluntarily. They can go through the Affordable Care Act also and offer their employees, but that's not a mandate. They're not forced
they can,
to do that.
So someone who has 49 or less employees
right.
can opt into the program?
Yes.
For them. Okay, excellent.
And one thing that individuals who are employed, and most people who have health insurance get it through their employers
okay.
in this country.
Absolutely.
One thing that people have to watch out for is that employers want to try to sneak around this law.
Mm-hmm.
They don't want to, many of them don't want to provide health care insurance, and especially if it looks like it's going to cost them more, which it probably will not. But what they will attempt to do, and Walmart has been guilty of this already, is to try to reduce the number of hours that employees work from, let's say, 40 down to 30 or less. Mm-hmm. If an employee works 30 or less hours, that employee does not, by law, have to be covered by health insurance. And so therefore the company gets away with not covering employees if the government doesn't crack down on them.
That's another reason to boycott
that.
Walmart, right?
Well, that's what I was going to talk about. We were talking about that at the break. Initially, the president said, if you like your health insurance, you can keep it.
Right.
But he has to shift with right. what's occurring on mm-hmm. a daily basis.
Absolutely.
Not taking into account about the corporate autonomy that has been enforced with such as Walgreens.
Mm-hmm.
Walgreens eliminated the insurance across the board of their employees, which allowed them to get their individual coverage.
Okay.
And so then maybe later down the road, they may find that consciousness and cover a portion
of
the employee's okay. insurance. So we have to keep that in mind.
Okay. Mm-hmm. All right.
But effective January 1st, 30 hours or more is considered full-time.
Full-time. That's right.
Mm-hmm. Oh, is he?
Yes.
Oh.
Yes.
So employers 50 and over, if you have employees that mm-hmm. are working 30 hours or more, you're required to provide the medical insurance for them.
Excellent.
That's right.
Excellent.
Mm-hmm.
Connie?
I wanted to go back to the Young Invincibles.
Okay. They do think they're invincible, right?
Mm-hmm. Comfort California had $43 million to award for outreach and education.
Okay.
Cal State LA, I think they were awarded, I don't know how much, but they are working within their health centers
mm-hmm.
on the colleges and partnering with the other Cal States
very
in
good.
Order to get the information out on the college campuses.
Okay.
Yeah,
very
I just
good.
Wanted to.
And I like that you point that out again. The thing that's going to make this mandate sustain mm-hmm. is those Young Invincibles.
Okay,
that's right.
So we absolutely in our communities need to reach out to them because that's what's going to make it sustainable.
Okay, very good.
Right.
Now, you guys have become certified trainers. How does one become a Covered California certified trainer? And who's becoming trainer? Can any community member? Do you have to have a medical background? Who are the educators that are getting certified? You're already in the medical field, but who's getting certified?
Now,
and how do you get certified?
Well, there's an exam. We had to have training. 2.5-day training, and then we set for the exam, and you pass the exam.
Okay.
But now you can actually go on to coveredca.com website, and there's some information regarding that. Now, if you think you can sit and go through the material, you can attempt to pass the exam.
Mm-hmm.
But this is a pretty in-depth law.
Okay.
And I'd have to say that you really need to study, because when it gets to the next level of enrollment counselors, and you sit down with these people, get your background checks done, that you have to know how to handle relaying this material, and you do not mail it.
Okay.
So that's one point to the public. Do not allow anyone to mail your application. You mail it yourself.
Okay.
So the training is very, very involved, but it has accessibility.
Okay. Anybody else on how to get certified or trained?
Well, I'm one of the trainers that train the certified enrollment counselors, and so I am absolutely in favor of people coming to the class.
I am too.
Because we get to have hands-on, we get to explain some of the intricacies that people may not get online. And I'm not against online training.
Okay.
But again, as a person that does the face-to-face training of the enrollment counselors and the outreach and education people, I, of course, support coming to class.
I know, and I learn better in the classroom.
Yeah,
I don't know.
Me.
I got ADD. I just forget. Do we still have a caller? Okay, caller, hi, you're on with the dialogue. You have a comment or question for our guest?
Yes, good evening, Starlett.
Hi.
Hi there. This is someone from the LA Talk Live family. This is Angela D. Joseph.
Hi.
And hi there,
Hello,
and
Angela.
I am on Thursday night. It's 6 o'clock.
Thank you so much for calling
in. You have a fantastic show, and I have to say hello to all my peeps there, Dr. Williams, to Dr. Hickey, to Connie, to Tori and Norma. Thank you for all that you all are doing to educate people. I'm actually studying right now to take the test.
Ooh,
great.
Enrollment counselor. So I'm listening very carefully to everything that you're saying. So I have a couple questions.
Very good.
As I'm going through the book, and by the way, I highly recommend taking the class because it's a lot of material, and to be quite honest with you, you need to have the interaction in the classroom because there's a lot of questions that come up, and it's better when you have a teacher there that you can actually ask questions to.
Excellent.
Couple of things on the the enrollment, the open enrollment this time is for 6 months until March 31st, but apparently you can also sign up if you're new to the state. Is that true? If somebody arrives in California after the enrollment period, can they still sign up anytime?
Yes, absolutely. In fact, there's a number of life-changing events that can happen where you can enroll after the initial enrollment period.
Right.
So there's a list of things that allow you. For example, if you have a child, your child can be enrolled in. If you get married, if you get adopted, or if you adopt someone. So these are kind of life-changing things that can happen if you get married.
Okay.
So that allow you to enroll in the program after open enrollment.
Okay, you said that twice. You've been talking to my daddy, huh?
I know.
Have you been getting married? What are you trying to say? And you had a second question.
Yes, I did.
I was thinking
and
that.
And this is something that I haven't heard on any newscast. I saw in our materials that if you have more than 3 children, that all the children after that are basically free on your insurance. You don't have to pay after the third child.
Is that
correct?
Is that right? Okay.
It's in the book.
Nice. Thank you so.
Out.
Thank you so much.
Child number 3.
You planning on having some more children?
I have a cousin who just had her 10th one. So
there's no more premium. Did.
That's good to know.
So is that true? Yes.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, and plans are like that now.
Okay.
If you have commercial coverage, a family plan might be mother, dad, and 3 kids or more.
Okay.
I mean, it doesn't keep adding on for each child.
Okay. Right. Thank you so much, caller, for your question. I appreciate that.
Okay. Oh, sure. And you all, thank you so much. Have a good time there.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
So, Dr. Hickey, I want to ask you, what after? I mean, you're going through this community effort to get everyone signed up. So what is your desire? Wants people to sign up. How do we get people then to go to the doctor?
Okay, well, that's a very important point. In fact, that's the point that I like to focus on.
Okay.
One of the things that's primary for us is to get our people to understand what the mandate is and to get there and sign up.
Mm-hmm.
Afterwards, it's not good enough to just sign up. Then we have to emphasize to our community to go to the doctor.
Absolutely.
To get screenings. You mentioned earlier about health disparities in our community, and you're right. Diabetes, cancer, hypertension, infant death, high rates of infant death. These are things that too often we take for granted in our community that it just happens, particularly, okay, for example, diabetes. We just accept that black men get diabetes. Right. Well, that's not something that's absolutely necessary. Some of the reasons those disparities exist is because we haven't had access to affordable quality care. Mm-hmm. Now we do. Mm-hmm. And so one step is to sign up. Second is to go to the doctor. Our immunizations now are free. One of the statistics you mentioned earlier about cancer, one of the statistics that I found startling is that African-American women are 10% less likely to have breast cancer than their white counterparts.
Is that right?
But less, 40% less more, less likely.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
But 40% more likely to die.
That's right.
Why is
so
that?
That's because we don't get screenings early enough to find out about it. And you don't have to go far in our community to talk with someone and meet someone that has experienced in their family or in their community.
I had 40 two women in my family that had breast cancer.
Yeah. 40 years or younger that die from breast cancer.
Wow.
Primarily because not getting screened, not finding out early enough, and not getting the kind of care and treatment. And so and this applies across the board to diabetes and those other things that we talked about. So it's important for us to not only sign up, but to get the word out that we must go to the doctor.
Okay. And black women have a more aggressive type of breast cancer as well.
Why is ours more aggressive?
That's we don't know why, but we know it is.
Okay.
Black women tend to be more endangered earlier, so they got to get to the doctor earlier.
All right, and Tori, quickly.
And I wanted to say that I did a paper on male breast cancer, and part of it is our
Breast cancer?
Male breast cancer, and part of it is our diet. Mm. And Richard Roundtree came out and brought a lot of awareness to male breast cancer, and he told me that he would come and do a show if we ever reach out to him.
I would love to have him come and talk about that.
Because that was very relative, because a lot of the doctors didn't even realize that men have breast cancer as well. And
absolutely.
The emergency room, we have an overutilization of the emergency room, and that's what caused a lot of our emergency rooms to close. So with that in mind, the emergency is one of the 10 essential health benefits, so they won't run to the emergency room and they'll get better extenuated health care within the realm of seeing an actual primary physician.
Excellent.
As opposed to going to the emergency room.
Excellent. Well, we're going to take a quick commercial break. And when we come back, I want to talk about these electronic health care records and how they benefit the black community and research to be able to help kind of close some of these health disparity gaps. Okay, so we're going to take a quick commercial break. We want you to be successful like Drake. You know, we want you to be educated on Obamacare. We're going to take a quick commercial break. Shout out to my music supervisor, Q2. We're going to take a quick commercial break and we'll be right back. Give us a call. We're talking about Obamacare 101 right here on The Dialogue.
I just want to be successful. I just want to be successful. Yeah, I want things to go my way.
We know there are many choices in internet radio, and the staff and host of LA Talk Live would like to thank you for choosing the internet's hottest destination for the most eclectic sound and invigorating talk. This is LA Talk Live. We are more than just talk. And 40 hours all before I showed up and brought $1,000 worth of drinks and got pulled up. Damn.
Are you tired of getting sick and tired? Are you tired of doctors not knowing what's wrong with you? D-Herbs may have the answer. D-Herbs, number one in herbal remedies. D-Herbs' main goal is to enlighten and properly educate people to the importance of human health and nutrition. D-Herbs, home of the full body cleanse. Everyone needs to cleanse. If you eat meat and dairy products, you need to cleanse. If you're eating processed foods, you need to cleanse. 90% of today's diseases that we suffer from are diet-related. Cleansing opens a door to healing and rejuvenation. Whether you need help with a chronic disease, weight loss, or to jumpstart and eliminate fatigue, D-Herbs Full Body Cleanse can help. There's a better way to live and healthier way to live. Experience healing. Visit us at dherbs.com. That's dherbs.com. Or call us at 866-434-3727. That's 866-434-3727.
Interested in advertising your business, product, or service here on The Dialogue? Call 323-547-7748. The Dialogue will help you promote your business, increase your traffic,
and bring in new clients
through innovative and creative marketing packages, including affordable radio ad campaigns for small businesses. Find out more. Call 323-547-7748. That's 323-547-7748. Or go to www.thedialoguela.com. And now, back to The Dialogue.
The Dialogue.
With Starlett Quarles.
Real talk. Real people.
Welcome back to The Dialogue. Real talk, real people. We're talking about Obamacare 101 and health disparities in the Black community with my esteemed panel of experts tonight. Dr. Chris Hickey, Sr., Executive Director of Each One Teach One. Connie Kizzy Gillette, founder of Lily's Care Circle. Norma Mtumi, co-founder of Shields for Family. And Dr. Richard Allen Williams, clinical professor of medicine at the USLA School of Medicine and the author of Healthcare Disparities at the Crossroads with Healthcare Reform. All here talking about health, Obamacare 101. And before I wanted to get to the electronic healthcare records, Norma, you want to mention about new patients under the expanded Medi-Cal and elaborate a little bit more on that.
Yes, I wanted to just interject that populations coming into the system, to the medical system now, are going to look a lot different than they have in the past.
Mm-hmm.
One of the things that the law does is it expands coverage for uninsured childless adults, okay. Which will be a lot of our brothers and sisters coming out of prison who were never eligible for any kind of insurance.
Excellent.
Before. They didn't work, they weren't eligible for Medi-Cal uh-huh. because they didn't have children.
Okay.
A number of these folks have never really had care in a primary care physician's office. They've waited till they've gotten extremely sick and gone to the emergency room. But it's going to look different. It's going to look a lot different. And it's going to be important for us to be able to embrace them when they come to the doctor's office. Okay. There's going to be a lot of re-education about, mm-hmm. you know, this is how you make an appointment. And when okay. you make an appointment, you keep it because you're taking up a spot that someone else could be using. But just a lot more education. Like you said, Dr. Hickey, enrollment okay. is the first piece.
And Richard, can you turn the music down just a little bit? Thank you. As it turned down. Okay. And I believe we have a caller. Do we, Richard? Okay, we're going to get to the electronic records, then we're going to take this call. Hi, caller, you're on with The Dialogue?
Hey, Janet from Spirit of Hope.
Oh, no,
your
phone is pop locking.
Is great, so I got the broken up part about the youth.
I'm sorry, say it one more time. Your phone is breaking
the youth.
Up.
And one of the things that I've noticed that some of them have gotten notification that they're going to be eligible for Medi-Cal come January. But I was trying to find out, is there any specific location where we could refer youth to go to see if they are going to be eligible or if they're actually going to be transferred automatically in January for Medi-Cal?
Okay, Tori. Thank you, caller.
On the line, they can go on thecoverca.com. They have calculators on there, and they can see if they're eligible online, and Norma has other information as well.
I'm sorry, you broke up and we didn't hear the first part. Were you talking about a specific population of young people?
They hung up. I think they were talking about young adults. I think your question was about young adults.
Right, in general.
Okay, because there are some special populations. For instance, young people who are timing out of foster care.
Okay.
They are automatically eligible. They okay. don't have to, right. you know, do all that proving and whatnot. So they can get enrolled right away.
Okay.
Right, but mm-hmm. she asked where can they go to see if they're eligible.
Yeah,
and you said online. Mm-hmm. They can check online.
Cover.
What about the gentlemen and ladies and gentlemen who are actually incarcerated? Does Obamacare help them in any way, shape,
no.
or form?
No.
No. Okay.
No.
All right. So it's only until you come out do we start embracing you and taking
if
care of you.
If they're pending.
Okay. Yeah.
Remember, if they're pending, there is a stipulation there.
Okay.
So make sure when they go online, let them okay. check. Don't just count them out.
Okay. Excellent.
And so, it's important to understand that women will get, I guess you might say, an extra bonus from Obamacare, and especially from expanded Medi-Cal.
Okay.
Very important because mm-hmm. most of the people who are on Medicaid throughout the country are women. Two-thirds are women.
Okay, very good.
But that doesn't mean that women are getting all of the same benefits that men are. And under Obamacare, okay. the playing field is leveled.
Okay,
women
very good.
Are looked at is the same as men.
Excellent.
Right, but that's Medi-Cal. It's been intrinsically linked to single moms. Mm-hmm. So now you don't have to be a mom to qualify for the Medi-Cal.
Okay. All right, very good. So, Dr. Hickey, before we went to commercial break, we talked about the electronic healthcare record. So explain what they are and then how they will essentially benefit the Black community and help with research.
Well, I want to start again and just kind of close the loop with the healthcare records.
Okay, very
good. We talked about first signing up. So that's a very important first step. And then we want to go to the doctor. And now what happens when we go to the doctor, part of the mandate that's not talked about as much is it mandates that the hospitals and clinics have electronic healthcare records set up for them that has meaningful use.
Yes.
And so what happens is when we go to the doctor now, they're getting records on the things that are happening with us. They're knowing about our diets, as you were mentioning. They mm-hmm. get research information about the environments we live in. They know about the medications that they're given. And these kinds of things can be shared within the clinic and the hospital and with other clinics.
Very good.
And so by the collection of this data, ultimately, researchers, Black researchers and others can find out the causes of these health disparities. Mm-hmm. And the whole idea is to sustain our community and find out reasons for these health disparities. And through electronic medical record, that provides us a vehicle. So we're looking at signing up. We're looking at going to the doctor, then we're making sure that in our community, meaningful use software is used to collect data so that we can then, our young people that have gone into the health profession that we talked about earlier, that are achieving better because they feel better, become the doctors and the nurses
and these
and
electronic
the
records can be shared. So if you go from one doctor and you go to another doctor, these electronic records can be shared.
Yes, so many times our people, you know, when they go to the doctor, they don't know what meds they're taking. They don't know the other information. They don't know what their vitals were the last time if they go to a different doctor. Well, this way they're able to keep all of that information and share it with others so that they're getting sustainable and consistent care and research data.
Okay, very good.
I'm so excited to hear this conversation. We have been talking about a true electronic health record for over 12 years now.
Okay.
I've been working on hybrid systems and we've worked on electronic, but when they say electronic health records, sometimes it's electronic medical records. Those acronyms are used interchangeably.
Mm-hmm.
But it's so exciting because the doctor can go in and just look up and review your diagnosis and the interaction and adverse effects of the medications. It is phenomenal.
Will consumers be able to have access to their electronic records?
Absolutely.
Yes.
Okay,
yeah,
Norma.
Absolutely.
Yes, that's the meaningful use part.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
But also there's a big piece about consent in here. Consumers will be able to say who it is that they want to release their information to. So
very
it's not supposed to just be a free-for-all that anybody can just go in and get what they want.
That's
there
excellent.
Needs to be some accountability for that as well.
So I want to, and in the final few minutes of the show, I want to talk about the health disparities. And then, Norma, I want us to end on just talking about mental illness because, you know, that's definitely a pink elephant in the Black community. But I definitely want to talk how Obamacare can help with that particular issue. But with you, Dr. Williams, explain to us, just elaborate a little bit more on the history of health disparities. I mean, when we spoke earlier, you had mentioned slavery.
Well,
so just talk about how the Black community has even evolved to have these health care inequalities in our community.
Okay, well, I'd like to bring things kind of full circle
back
to where we started.
Okay.
We started out talking about health care disparities. And to make a long story short, literally, and it is a long story, we have to go all the way back to slavery to look at the origins of healthcare disparities. This is where it all got started, with the poor health conditions that existed among the slaves. That's been passed on to the survivors of the slaves, us.
Mm-hmm.
We suffer what we call the slave health deficit over all of these centuries. It's been 400 years since slavery started, 150 years since slavery was since the Emancipation Proclamation. And still, at this time, people are suffering from the effects of poor health delivery during and after slavery.
Mm-hmm.
So healthcare disparities really can be defined as those differences, as you indicated early on, in disease states and status among Americans. To make a long story shorter, white Americans, for instance, receive a higher standard of health care delivery and therefore have better health status than black Americans do.
Now, how did you make this connection between cultural competency?
How do I make the connection?
How did you come from medicine? How did you make that connection between medicine and cultural competency? Because we talk about it here on our show, but I didn't know that it stemmed from a medical
perspective.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Well, it actually stems, it originates in medicine.
Very good.
Cultural competency is something that, as you indicated, I first described as a humane medicine situation. That is, whether medical care is dispensed in a humane fashion throughout our populace. And we find that it is not. So we need to change that and make sure that our providers, that is the doctors and other health professionals, dispense health care in an equitable fashion.
Very good.
And the Obamacare does help to do that.
Mm-hmm. Excellent.
Now, I just want to finally segue into something, back into something that Dr. Hickey mentioned in regards to electronic health records, and make it clear that EHR, electronic health records, actually improves the situation from the standpoint of healthcare disparities. How does that happen? Mm-hmm. It's because of something that you mentioned earlier, Dr. Hickey, and that is that we find that the statistics that are gathered give us a clear indication of how much difference there is in healthcare dispensation. And so the first principle of meaningful use, according to what is set up as a mandate under Obamacare, is that healthcare records have to be collected according to race and ethnicity. Mm-hmm. That means that every doctor who puts in something into the EHR about an individual has to mention that individual's race or ethnic group.
Very good.
And that's important because therefore we can collect the statistics. We can find out those things about the differential in breast care incidence and prevalence and mortality.
Excellent.
Which we did not know before. 40 years ago, I wrote a book called The Textbook of Black-Related Diseases, which defined all of the diseases that blacks are particularly vulnerable to. An 800-page book.
Wow.
That never had been done before or since. The importance of that is that for the first time, we had some impetus to collecting data according to race and ethnicity, which would give us a clear idea of what kind of disparities existed. Mm-hmm. The federal government did not do that before that book was published. They now do it.
Excellent. Yes. Very good. Yes. So I wanted to ask the gentleman on our panel about, kind of piggybacking what you said about once you get signed up actually going to the doctor, and this issue with black men not going to the doctor as often as they should. Now, we gonna get in the stirrups. You know, women, we gonna go to the doctor. We gonna make sure we fresh. But for the most part, men, they don't often go to the doctor as often. So what is that about? What is it about, brothers? I mean, I have, you know, cousins who said they ain't been to the doctor since he was in high school and hasn't got a checkup. So why don't black men go to the doctor?
Well, I think there's two reasons. One is I'm going to harken back to the cultural competence. You know, just culturally, you know, there's a tendency, particularly for African-American men. But I'm also going to say that it could very well be the affordability.
Okay.
You know, and we're not going to say we can't afford. Because, I mean, there's a lot of other things that we have to deal with our community as black men, and so going to the doctor when we're not sick is just not at the top of our priority.
How do you know you're not sick?
That's the thing that's so important.
Okay,
what we're talking about is that the Affordable Care Act allows you now to afford to go and find out that, and it's not just, I'm glad you mentioned that, it's not just about being sick. It's about staying well.
Absolutely. You know,
and so we're going to the doctor and we're putting that, as community leaders, if we're putting that message out, and when I say community leaders, I mean all of us in the community, families, talk to your brothers, talk to your cousins, talk to your sons, talk to your daughters as well about the advantage of the Affordable Care Act is to allow us to, like you say, find out before you get sick.
That's
ways
exactly.
to stay well and find out these things that may be dormant in you. Find out those things, and so we can alleviate some of those issues.
And it's not just medical. I mean, it covers, you know, vision and dental.
Absolutely. Yes. In fact, for children, dental and vision is free.
Okay. Yes,
and so now what we're finding out, again, there's a big correlation between how kids achieve in school with how they feel. So some of the times in our school, Johnny is in the back of the room and he can't see. You know, so his teacher's asking him to read something on the board he can't see, and he doesn't say, I can't see. He just acts up.
Okay.
And so then he's shipped off to special ed. And so it's important that we get our children in so that they get vision and they get hearing and dental so that they feel good and they look good and they perform better.
Excellent, Tori.
The vision and dental is not going to be in the first wave.
Okay.
So it's going to come in the latter part of 15 or early 16.
For children, it's free now.
For adults.
Right. One last thing about the prostate, since you asked the men on the panel.
I'm going to have you come back next week.
See, I was going to stay away from that one. I don't want to deal with that.
See, men don't want to deal with it. See? What does it take? Ten seconds? I mean, really?
How long are you up in there?
You ain't in there long.
Not long.
Okay.
But I always like to tell my brothers, don't become prostrate because of your prostate. that's very important.
That is important.
Yeah. So
we want you guys to get that exam. It's got to work. To a large extent,
it's a macho thing, too.
Okay, very good.
Have to teach our brothers who have the highest incidence of prostate cancer in the world, and especially in California, that... they have to go and get themselves examined. As you said, it doesn't take long.
Mm-hmm.
And to compare it to breast cancer, prostate cancer in men occurs, seems to be, especially in black men, occurs earlier.
Okay.
And is more devastating much more quickly.
Now, we're going to elaborate on this topic a little bit more next week, but I did want to ask, I had a gentleman who recently told me that he was just getting over prostate cancer, and he would get the rectal exams, but it wasn't discovered until he got a blood exam. Is that sometimes often the case? Like, you really get confirmation with blood more so than from the rectal exam?
Yeah.
Okay.
We call the rectal exam a DRG, a digital rectal, a DRE,
okay.
a digital rectal examination. That can sometimes miss it.
Okay.
So the best thing is a combination, of course.
To just bring that home as well, I want to just point out that African-American men are 2.5 more likely to die of prostate cancer than their counterpart.
Wow. And so, I mean, you only get a checkup once a year? How often are you supposed to get your prostate checked?
That's fine. Just once a year?
Mm-hmm. Okay. All right. Norma, you want to say something?
Yes. And like Dr. Williams was saying, I think one piece of it, too, is the psychological residual from slavery, Jim Crow.
Absolutely.
We just don't trust.
Absolutely.
We don't trust that they're going to do the right thing.
Exactly.
We really can't leave that out, because that's a big reason that a lot of folks we're going to have to pull from under rocks to get them registered to even enroll in the plans.
And that's an excellent segue to talk about mental illness. I mean, Connie and I sit on a board where we're trying to help encourage research for African Americans who are suffering from Alzheimer's. And it's just hard trying to get black people to come to the table because of either their religious beliefs, or they think God gonna heal them, or they're just getting old and things of that nature. So talk about how Obamacare and the integration of mental health services can help the black community in terms of dealing with some of our mental issues.
Okay, what we're working with now are siloed systems. If you have a headache or something's wrong with your body, you go to your doctor. If you're depressed or you have something else going on, you may go to your doctor. He may give you medication. Every now and then you may get referred for talk therapy. But 9 times out of 10, the medical doctor, help me if I'm wrong here, Dr. Williams, is not trained to deal with behavioral health concerns.
Okay.
Exactly right.
Move closer to the mic, please.
Not trained to deal with behavioral health concerns. Mm-hmm. Where we have folks in the community that substance abuse and mental health, we've been doing for 30, 40 years. Mm-hmm. What Obamacare directs to happen in the systems is that they're to come together.
Okay.
And they're to provide services in an integrated manner. If you have a substance abuse problem now, 9 times out of 10 in South L.A., you would go to a substance abuse agency.
Mm-hmm.
And that still is available to us. But under Obamacare, there seems to be a leaning more to the doctor's supposed to provide everything for you. The patient-centered services in medical homes, if you have a problem, you go to the doctor, and he's supposed to make sure that you get your medical services, your mental health services, your substance abuse services. And it's really important that the various systems come together in order for this to be successful. And I think that this is one of the ways that we'll be able to help to decrease the disparities, because most of the time with folks in our community, they don't have just one illness. They're suffering with what they call comorbid, two or three or more conditions. They may be using drugs. They're depressed.
Mm-hmm.
And they have high blood pressure.
Absolutely.
Now they got diabetes. Mm-hmm. Now they're more depressed because they got diabetes and they can't eat.
Right.
So, I mean, there are a lot of things that are mixed together, and we have to figure out how we're going to work with all these systems, you know, really connecting.
And you talked about the realignment and the reentry and some of the ills that some of our, you know, returning citizens, as Alpha Omega likes to call them, returning citizens from the PTSD. From
exactly.
PTSD, from being incarcerated.
Military.
From the military, absolutely. Mm-hmm. Even from domestic abuse and not really acknowledging that some, you know, children and women are experiencing signs of PTSD as a result of domestic violence. And some at the end of the month, we're going to talk about young girls and sex trafficking. So there's all these different issues that impact our mental healthness that, you know, Obamacare or, you know, Covered California could be able to assist in closing those gaps.
Exactly. So many traumas that folks, and we find out in substance abuse that, you know, a very large number of the women who come in have been abused in some manner, and thus, you know, we know where they end up. So we have to learn how to address those traumas earlier in children, to do mental health services with the children, to make sure that they get what they need so that they can.
And I don't think we talk about sexual abuse and incest and physical abuse with women enough. I mean, I was recently sharing with somebody, I was watching a reality show, unfortunately, but I was watching a reality show with these five celebrity women, and they were all kind of giving their testimony, and all of them, to some degree, were sexually molested, either by a family member or by a neighbor or someone that they knew, and it's now, you know, coming out in terms of their adulthood. So there's these issues that we are dealing with in our homes as Black people that we just are kind of sweeping under the rug,
exactly.
Because everybody has someone that has some type of mental illness in their family.
I used to work with a girl, and it was her dad that was doing the abusing. And it was so interesting because the mom never did respond to it. And so he got away with it because with the neighbors, it looked like he was just being an overprotective dad. And so we need to be alert on those type of issues.
Absolutely.
And she ran away. They bought her back, and when he went to the next daughter was more outspoken, and she let it be known what was going on. And so I think she ended up going to live with the other sister, but it's very prevalent. It's more prevalent than we know. And what really sticks out in my mind is the pastor that was on Oprah years ago who had children with his daughters who thought that was normal. And until they started going out into society, realizing that wasn't the case.
Exactly. And so we definitely need to deal with a lot of these mental health issues as well as physical in our Black community. But I'm going to go do a round table. I'm going to start with you, Dr. Allen, the author of Healthcare Disparities at the Crossroads with Healthcare Reform. What final words do you have for our audience about Obamacare?
My final words is to make sure that everybody recognizes that we are all victims from the standpoint of being subjected to inferior health care delivery, especially in the minority and particularly in the Black community. And finally, also to emphasize something that Norma mentioned, we must make sure that Black people go to the doctor, that they are not too suspicious or overly paranoid and don't go to the doctor. Somebody once said that if you're Black in America and you're looking at health care and going to the doctor and so forth, you do get a little suspicious, and that a Black person in America who is not somewhat paranoid about these things is really crazy.
Thank you so much. Dr. Higley, quickly, how can people find you?
Oh, I can be found at area code 323-945-9851. And in my closing remarks, I wanted to say that, again, this is not just about being sick, it's about staying well.
That's right.
And as well, with all of the verbiage that you hear over the TV and all the negative things, keep in mind that this act is about providing our citizens with access to affordable care, quality care for them and their families. So it's very important that we get that message out. It's just about affordable care for them and their family, including their children.
And you're going to let me know when you have another event coming up, right?
I most definitely will.
Tell us a little bit about Lily's care and how we can find you.
Okay, I can be found at area code 323-447-6718.
And they're both on Facebook, so look them up on Facebook. I'm sorry, but go ahead.
And I'd like to say that the Affordable Care Act Our main thing is for preventive care. We want to go to the doctors for our screenings, colonoscopies, preventive care, and it is now affordable. Yes. And it's our social justice right.
Thank you so much, Connie. Norma, how can people find you?
I'm at Shields for Families, 323-242-5000, extension 1266. And I'd like to say that Affordable Care Act or Obamacare, it's a big step in the right direction. Yeah. It's the first step. Get enrolled, stay involved, and tell somebody.
Do you have any events coming up?
I know.
But you'll let us know when you do.
Right, but we have folks that can help you get enrolled.
Actually, you do. You just haven't been told about it yet.
And close us out, Tori. How can people find you?
310-991-6622 since cell phones been invented.
I want to thank all.
Just keep in mind, this is patient protection.
Patient protection. I hope we answered some of your questions on Obamacare. We're going to continue our conversation this month on health disparities in the Black community. We will be talking about prostate cancer next week, followed by mental illness, and then we're going to close this month off talking about AIDS and sex trafficking. Again, thank you so much for joining us today for Obamacare 101. Last time, I want you to please check out Dr. Richard Allen Williams' book, Healthcare Disparities at the Crossroads with Healthcare Reform. Thank you all again so much for joining us. Thank you to my music supervisor, Quinta Quarles, Q2 Infinity, and my show engineer, Richard Carr. Again, join us next week for The Dialogue with me, Starlett Quarles, signing off as my mama's child and my daddy's baby girl. Until next week.
To my political soldiers, the refugees.
Teachers on strike, no more school today. They want more money, but the board won't pay.
Bullet.
Liquor store on every corner. Take back the community. Cause it's hot like a sauna. 50 cent sodas, tropical fantasies. Sterilize the sperm to stop the black seed. Chinese trying to get us with MSG. They don't even eat the food they serve, and what it be? Genocide, triple fold. Bad business going on in the hood, and we got no control. Meat in the supermarket, mad old. Mark down the prices, that shit is guaranteed to get sold. But what you want the broke to do? That shit is economical to my pocket, so I eat it too. Only as free as your choices. You know it's bad, but you disregard your inner voices. Get a license for your peace and patrol the block. I gotta do the same, let's go join the flock. Blood, Crips, Latin Kings, and whoever else. Take back the block, we got nothing else. Show them why the gang got together in the first place. So our people have a chance in this rap race. I own ambulances, I own police force. Cause 911 has no remorse, I'm saying. Meet your firemen and cook for them every day. So when your crib on fire, they coming with no delay. Makes sense.
We know there are many choices in internet radio, and the staff and host of LA Talk Live would like to thank you for choosing the internet's hottest destination for the most eclectic sound and invigorating talk. This is LA Talk Live. We are more than just talk.
Make the next verse is you. Go.